हेलो फ्रेंड्स, माय सेल्फ सीए उर्विश शाह डीलिंग विद द सब्जेक्ट ऑफ ऑडिटिंग एट आईपीसीसी अर्लियर नाउ इंटरमीडिएट एज वेल एज एट सीए फाइनल लेवल। आई एम फैकल्टी एट नवकार इंस्टीट्यूट। आई एम वेलकमिंग यू ऑल ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ नवकार डिजिटल इंस्टीट्यूट विच इज अ कंप्लीट सॉल्यूशन फॉर ऑल सब्जेक्ट्स एट ऑल लेवल। टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू स्टार्ट विद दिस सब्जेक्ट एडवांस ऑडिटिंग एंड प्रोफेशनल एथिक्स फॉर सीए फाइनल। वॉट इज द इम्पोर्टेंस ऑफ दिस सब्जेक्ट? द वे इन विच द एमबीबीएस इज नोन एज डॉक्टर्स इन अ सिमिलर वे सीएस आर नोन एज ऑडिटर्स। The importance of this subject I can mention by saying that 3 years articleship training prescribed by ICAI just to learn this particular subject. The subject is of 100 marks, falling in a first group, and basically this is a scoring subject, but I have seen students are always having fear of this particular subject. Believe me, the day when we are ending with this subject, you will find that the subject is really easy. Today we are going to start with a particular topic and which is known as advanced auditing professional ethics, in which the topic is professional ethics. Ethical requirement is there in every profession. In case of doctor's profession, it's a medical council which is prescribing the ethical rules. In case of lawyer's profession, it's a bar council, as well as in case of CA profession, it's ICAI's council which is prescribing ethical rules. In fact, under professional ethics, we will study Chartered Accountant Act 1949, which came into force on 1st July 1949, and that's why we celebrate 1st July as a CA Day. This act was amended in the year 2006, and we will study the amended version. Basically, this particular topic is having weightage of 16 marks. Earlier, this topic was asked in the paper as a question 1 when I was studying, but nowadays it is being asked as question 2 or question 5. And where they ask 4 practicals, and each practical would be of 4 marks. This is being the most important topic, scoring topic from examination point of view. As a part of our syllabus, we will study in total all the topics, but the first topic with which I am starting today, and that is professional ethics. Within professional ethics, we will study 3 things. Number 1, Chartered Accountant Act 1949, which is amended in the year 2006. We know that as and when there is an act, there are rules, like Income Tax Act, Income Tax Rules. But here we have regulations. So we will also study Chartered Accountant Regulation 1988. And third thing we will study, that is Council General Guidelines 2008. So as a part of our syllabus within professional ethics, we will study 3 things. Chartered Accountant Act 1949, amended in 2006. Chartered Accountant Regulation 1988 and Council General Guidelines 2008. Now, this Chartered Accountant Act is basically bifurcated in 4 parts, 4 first schedule and second schedule. First schedule, where there are 4 parts. First schedule, where council is taking decision. Part 1, where a council is taking decision against CA in practice. Part 2, where council is taking decision against CA in service. Part 3, where council can take decision CA in general. And fourth, that is other misconduct which is not a professional misconduct. So, part 1 is applicable to CA in practice, part 2 CA in service, part 3 CA in general, and part 4, that is other misconduct. The second schedule, where counsel can refer this matter to the court, is being bifurcated in 3 parts. Part 1, that is CA in practice, part 2 CA in general, part 3, that is other misconduct. In each part, we will have different clauses. We are going to start with a first part, first clause. Basically, first part, first clause is talking about a CA in practice cannot allow anyone else to use his firm name except he is being a partner or he is being an employee, provided employee is also a CA in practice. You might have seen, you must be going for articleship. Can you make a visiting card that I am being an article of so-and-so firm? Not at all, because you can't make use of this firm name. Within your firm, there may be some data operator. Can he make use of the firm name that I am a data operator of so-and-so firm? No, because who can make use of the firm name? The firm name can be used by a proprietor, by a partner, by an employee, provided employee is also CA in practice. Normally, after discussing every clause, we will discuss the practical, but not a single practical related with this clause is given, neither in my book, nor in PM, nor in RTP, nor in ICAI module. And they have never asked any practical question related with this particular clause. But I want to summarize this clause by saying that you cannot allow anyone else to make use of your firm name except your partner or employee, provided employee is also CA in practice. If we discuss about the second clause, we are within part 1. Part 1 is applicable to CA in practice. There are in fact 12 clauses, out of which this is being clause number 2. Clause number 2 is talking about that a CA in practice cannot allow anyone else to share fees. In fact, he cannot share his fees with anyone else except FI. He can share his fees only with a partner, retired partner, legal representative after death of partner, any other professionals permitted within Regulation 53A and any other CA in practice. So there are five with whom he can share the fees. Number one, partner. Number two, retired partner. Number three, legal representative after death of partner. Number four, professionals permitted within Regulation 53A, which was introduced in the amendment 2006. And number five, any other CA in practice. Now, which professionals with whom we can share the fees? There is a list of the professional with whom we can share the fees, like company secretary, cost accountant, actuarial valuer, bachelor in engineering, bachelor in technology, bachelor in architect, bachelor in law, and MBA. This list is provided within Regulation 53A, and we can share fees only with them under Regulation 53A. So now there are five professional, otherwise we cannot share our fees with anyone else. If I speak further within this particular clause, there is a situation like death of a proprietor and death of a partner. What is happening in case of a death of a partner? After the death of the partner, the remaining partner can share the fees with a widow or legal representative if it is written within terms. So in case of a death of a partner in a partnership firm, sharing of fees is permissible. But in case of a death of a proprietor, widow or legal representative can sell the entire profession with goodwill, means with the use of firm name, to any other CA in practice within 1 year. Why there is a specific requirement of 1 year? Because institute is always maintaining a register of members, which is updating every year, where we are paying the membership fees. After the death of the partner, particular person, a particular proprietor, the name won't be updated. And second, another practical reason, the clients can stop only up to 1 year, because every year they need to file income tax return, audit, GST return, and that's why they will be in search of some chartered accountant. So in case of a death of a proprietor, widow or legal representative can sell the entire profession with goodwill within 1 year. But the person who is buying this profession can make one stroke payment to widow or legal representative. That one stroke payment may be 15 lakhs, 20 lakhs can be paid in installment. But afterwards, subsequently, he cannot share the fees with widow or legal representative. If he's sharing the fees with widow or legal representative, then that chartered accountant would be subject to clause 2. So now I want to clarify. Number one, in case of a death of a partner, a CA in practice, if in case of a particular firm, if a particular partner is dying, the remaining partner can share the fees with widow or legal representative, but that is not possible in case of a death of a proprietor, because the person buying this profession can make one stroke payment that can be paid in installment, but subsequently he cannot share the fees. Second important point which I want to discuss in Cooperative Societies Act, which may be of three different types. It may be a Central Act 1912, it may be Multi-State Act, or it may be a particular state act. In various states, the appointment of auditor of a cooperative society is made by the registrar, and appointment is done through empanelment. Within empanelment process, it is being a requirement that here the auditor will pay, he will share certain amount of fees with the registrar for the administrative expenses. Suppose in the state of Tamil Nadu. So at that time, chartered accountants were in a dilemma that our clause 2 is not allowing us to share our fees with anyone else except those five. Again, I repeat, those five: a partner, a retired partner, legal representative after death of partner, any other professionals permitted within Regulation 53A, and any other CA in practice. So how can we share our fees with the registrar of a cooperative society? And afterwards, this matter went with the council, and council took the call that if it is being a requirement of a particular state, in that case you can share your fees with the registrar and it will not violate clause 2. So now if we share our fees with the registrar, if it's being a requirement of that particular state, then it can be shared and it won't be treated as violation of clause 2. After discussing this clause 2, I would like to discuss about the various practicals. Practicals, they are asking in the examination, and we need to answer in two parts. First part would be clause itself, and the second part would be correlation of that clause to that particular question, where we need to write our ultimate answer. Basically, you need to keep in mind when you are studying the subject of audit, I will also give you certain suggestions. There are three ways. Number one, read. Number two, learn. And number three, learn by heart. So far as clauses are concerned, it is not falling in read or learn criteria, rather it is falling in the criteria of learn by heart. You will have to learn by heart the clauses word to word, and you need to write accordingly. If you have seen the suggested answers of past papers, you must be observing their writing clauses word to word. If you really wish to get 4 out of 4 marks for each question, you will have to learn that particular clause by heart. Now, practicals related with this. Every time I will categorize a particular chapter, like this professional ethics, if someone asks me, I will categorize the chapter into A, B and C category. I will categorize this particular chapter in A category. A is falling in a category where in each examination they are asking question out of it. B is falling where in a 2 or 3 exam they are asking one question out of it. And C category in 4 or 5 exam they are asking question out of it. So far as professional ethics is concerned, it is of 16 marks. They are asking in every examination, and we need to learn it particularly from all sources, out of my book, out of PM and out of ICI module. If we start with the practicals of clause 2, the first practical is related with Mr. Q, a chartered accountant in practice as a proprietor, died in a road accident. His widow sold the practice of her husband to another chartered accountant in practice for 5 lakhs. The price also included the right to use the firm name. Now the question arises that in this particular case, can widow sell the practice in this particular way? Yes. In case of a death of a proprietor, the widow can sell the entire profession with goodwill within 1 year. But the person buying this profession need to make sure that he is making one stroke payment. He may make the payment in installment, but subsequently he should not share the fees. If he is sharing the fees subsequently, that widow is not subject to clause 2 because she is not a chartered accountant, but that chartered accountant is subject to clause 2 part 1 first schedule. You need to keep in mind when you are writing answer in the examination, clause 1, 2, 3, 4 you need to write in numeric. Part 1, 2, 3, 4 would be a Roman number, and first schedule, second schedule you will have to write in words. So what would be the answer for this particular question? The first paragraph you need to write the clause itself word to word, and in the second paragraph you will have to correlate the clause with this particular question, in which we will write that here the person buying the profession can make one stroke payment, but subsequently he cannot share the fees, and if he is sharing the fees he would be held responsible under clause 2 part 1 first schedule of Chartered Accountant Act 1949. Here you need to keep in mind that clause you need to write word to word. One more suggestion I want to give you. You are getting 15 minutes extra for the purpose of reading your paper. You need to make sure that in that 15 minutes you are specifically reading the questions of professional ethics. After reading the questions, you need to decide clauses applicable to that particular question. And as and when you get the answer sheet, immediately you should start writing that clauses. There would be 4 questions. So clauses on different pages. For each clause, you need to keep 1 page. Before you forget that particular clause, because you must have learned it by heart, you need to write that particular clause and you should keep a space for writing further answer. Within first 15 minutes, you will get your answers of 16 marks. That would be your success. Again, I repeat, as and when you get a question paper, 15 minutes you are getting extra for reading the paper. You should not read any other part except professional ethics. 4 questions would be there. You need to judge the clause. And after judging the clause, as and when you get the answer sheet, on different 4 pages, you need to pen down all the clauses word to word what you mug up. And you need to keep a space for the purpose of writing further answer. And after writing all those 4 clauses on different pages, you should correlate that particular question with the clause. In this way, what will happen, within first 15 to 20 minutes, your paper of 16 marks would be over. I will also guide you how to write the paper also, where there should be a proper time scheduling of each part. For any student I want to convey in any subject, but specifically for the subject of advanced auditing and professional ethics, I want to convey that three care need to be taken. First of all, you need to give a justice to your subject by devoting minimum 15 to 20 days. Second, your management for a last day. And third, your management of 3 hours of paper. If you manage all these three, first preparation, last day preparation, and 3 hours of writing, then you can score very well marks in this particular subject. So far as this first question is concerned, as I said, that the person buying the profession can make the one-stroke payment, but subsequently cannot share the fees. If he's sharing fees, he would be subject to close to part one first schedule. Let's move to the question two. Chartered accountant obtain a loan from a finance company for purchase of office building, agreeing to pay interest at the rate of 6% per annum and 10% of his gross professional receipts till the loan is repaid. This question, I can say, is not there available neither in RTP nor in PM. It's really important question. If you face this question, it is quite possible your answer may be wrong. A chartered accountant has taken a loan, and for paying that loan, he has decided to give 10% of his income as a loan installment. Basically, whenever we take the loan, we are making payment of EMI, and EMI is always being paid out of our earning. But that EMI can be in amount 5,000, 6,000, 10,000. But when you are sharing your fees 10%, in that case, as if you are sharing your fees with a bank, and you cannot share your fees with a bank, it is not falling within that five permitted categories. And that's why in this particular question, that chartered accountant is subject to close to part one first schedule. So as and when a chartered accountant is taking a loan, he is making payment of installment, he is paying interest. Paying interest is also not a fault. It must be paid. But at the same time, it should be a fixed amount, 5,000, 10,000 EMI every month, but it cannot be a percentage of his earning. Otherwise, he is subject to close to part one first schedule. Moving to the third question. The third question is talking about a practicing chartered accountant agree to share his fees with an advocate in respect of the clients introduced by him. Now, basically for this particular question, I want to convey that earlier, before 2006, before the act was amended, it was not being permitted to share fees with anyone else except chartered accountant. So chartered accountants earlier, they were sharing their fees only with chartered accountants under close to. But afterwards, Regulation 53A introduced, and where there are 8 professionals, we recently learned, the lawyer, the MBA, bachelor in engineer, bachelor in technology, bachelor in architect, actuarial valuer, cost accountant, company secretary, we can share fees with them. And in a current question, as we are sharing fees with an advocate, it won't be treated as a violation of clause 2 because it is falling within the exception under Regulation 53A. And that's why in a current case, this particular chartered accountant is not making violation of clause 2, part 1, first schedule. Moving to the next question. The next question is related with Mr. Dessing, a practicing chartered accountant, has accepted the assignment of preparation of a project report for a chemical industry jointly with a chemical engineer. Again, answer would be more or less same. As I recently said, earlier it was not being permitted for a chartered accountant to share his fees with anyone else. But now, from 2006 onwards, we can share with 8 other professionals, and out of which we can also share our fees with the engineer, bachelor in engineering. And that's why we can share our fees with the chemical engineer. Nothing is wrong. It won't be treated as violation of clause 2, part 1, first schedule. The next question, a chartered accountant, ex a practicing chartered accountant, paid 25% of audit fees received by him to his employee Y, who was an MCOM, under the nomenclature of office allowances, and such an arrangement continued for a number of years. Comment. Now, this is a good question. That office nomenclature, office terms are saying that every year you need to share certain amount of your fees with the office staff. It should not be in percentage terms. Whatever amount you want to give in terms of bonus or otherwise, it may be 50,000, it may be 5 lakhs, it can be distributed among staff if the staff is working well. You can pay them salary, you can give them bonus, but you cannot share your fees with a fixed percentage with the office staff because they are not falling within the five permitted categories. Again, if I give you a reminder of five permitted category: partner, retired partner, legal representative after death of partner, other professional permitted within regulation 53A, and any other CA in practice. So in this particular case, as you are sharing your fees with the office staff, a fixed percentage. You keep in mind, instead of 25%, if it is written, he's sharing amount of 5 lakhs with the office staff, nothing is wrong. Because that is not a percentage of his earning. And as in current case, it's a fixed percentage of his earning. Office nomenclature or office terms are not important. Professional ethics is important. And that's why in this particular case, it would be treated as violation of clause 2, part 1, first schedule. Again, I want to convey, every answer you need to write in two part, two paragraph. First paragraph would be clause itself, and the second paragraph where you need to correlate that particular clause with the question. Now moving to the next clause. The next clause is talking, which is reverse to clause 2. We cannot share our fees with anyone else except FI. Now clause 3 is reverse to clause 2, which is saying we cannot share the fees of others. We cannot share the fees of others. You need to keep in mind, we cannot share our fees with others, that is clause 2, and we cannot share the fees of others, that is clause 3. Clause 3, if I give you an example, suppose my clients are asking me where I should make tax saving investments. I know particular investment broker, and I am always referring a name of that investment broker. And that investment broker is giving me commission, because whatever commission he is earning out of my client, a certain portion is passing on to me. Here I am not sharing my fees with someone, but I am sharing fees of someone. It would be treated as violation of clause 3. So does it mean that I cannot share fees of anyone? Not at all. I can share fees of those who were sharing my fees under clause 2. Means what? I can share the fees of all those who were sharing my fees under clause 2, partner, retired partner, legal representative, regulation 53A, all professionals of regulation 53A, and any other CA in practice. So clause 3 is reversed to clause 2. There would be certain practicals, and in those practicals what will happen, it will be a combination of clause 2 and 3, where in a particular question we need to mention clause 2 as well as clause 3. If we see the practicals, the practical number 1 is talking about a CA in practice examine the financial aspects of a consultancy job obtained by a consulting engineer and share profit with him. Now this particular question is a good question, not given in PM. Basically, in this particular question, it is difficult to judge whether chartered accountant is sharing his fees with others or he is sharing fees of others. Then how to judge? For that particular, there is one way. You need to see who got the work. In this particular question, it is being mentioned that the work was obtained by the engineer. And as engineer was getting the job, and that's why he is sharing his fees with the chartered accountant. So you need to observe who is getting the work. The job is obtained by the engineer, and that's why engineer is sharing his fees with the chartered accountant, and that's why we are not applying clause 2, we are applying clause 3. Straight away, if you find this question in the examination, you may be in a dilemma whether should I apply clause 2 or clause 3. You need to make sure who is getting the job. The person getting the job, obviously he will share his work and he will share his fees. But can we share the fees of an engineer? Yes, because he is falling within regulation 53A, and 53A is permitting that yes, you can share your fees with engineer, with LLB, with company secretary, with actuarial valuer, with cost accountant. These are the professionals with whom we can share our fees, and we can also share the fees of them. And that's why in a current case, it won't be treated as violation of clause 3. Again, I repeat, decision need to be taken regarding clause 2 and clause 3. You need to observe who got the job. If a chartered accountant is getting job and he is sharing his work and if he is sharing his fees, then clause 2 will be applied. But if job is obtained by the engineer, in that particular case, he is sharing his work and he is sharing his fees, and that's why clause 3 would become applicable. The next practical, if we see, Ajay is a practicing chartered accountant, Vijay is a practicing advocate. Representing matters in the courts of law, Ajay and Vijay agree to help each other in the matters involving their professional expertise. Accordingly, Ajay recommend Vijay in all tax litigation in courts of law. Vijay consult Ajay on all matters relating to finance and related matters which came to him for arguing in various courts of law. Ajay seeks your advice on how he and Vijay should remunerate each other and share the remuneration. Basically, for this particular question, I can say it was being asked in a recent past, maybe in the paper of November 17. Here, we can apply both the clauses, clause 2 and clause 3. First fundamental rule, can we share our fees with the advocate and can we share the fees of advocate or not? And the answer is yes, because he is falling within a list of 53A. So in this particular question, we'll have to write down clause 2 first, clause 3 first, and our ultimate conclusion would be that here it won't be treated as violation of clause 2, violation of clause 3. Reason behind, advocate is falling in a permitted category, and that's why we can share the fees with the advocate and as well as we can share the fees of advocate as well. Let's discuss about clause 4. Clause 4 is talking about a chartered accountant in practice can make partnership with whom? In India, chartered accountant in practice can make partnership with 2 and in abroad with 3. In India, a chartered accountant in practice can make partnership with any other CA in practice as well as other professionals permitted within regulation 53B. You need to keep in mind it's 53B. Whereas in abroad, a CA in practice can make partnership with 3. Number 1, whoever is being permitted within section 415, section 4, subsection 1, clause 5. Now, who is falling within this section 415? Basically, Indian chartered accountant staying abroad. Suppose a chartered accountant firm is having some outsourcing work. This is what observed. They are keeping one partner in out of India, suppose in USA. So, that particular chartered accountant is staying in USA, generating work from them and bringing it to India. In that particular case, a chartered accountant is staying in abroad. Still, we can have a partnership with him because he is falling within section 4, subsection 1, clause 5. Second, with whom we can make partnership with in abroad. Second, that is whoever is being permitted by central government. And third, whoever is being permitted by the council. So in India, we can make partnership with 2, CA in practice, other professionals permitted within regulation 53B. That list we will also observe who are falling within that other professionals. As well as in abroad, we will make partnership, we can make partnership with whoever is falling within section 415, whoever is being permitted by central government and whoever is being permitted by the council. Now let's see who is being permitted within regulation 53B. More or less, the list of regulation 53B is matching with 53A. Obviously, we are sharing fees with those with whom we are making the partnership. And that's why we can make partnership with company secretary, cost accountant, advocate, engineer, architect, actuarial valuer. These are the professionals with whom we can make the partnership. Now, this permission was granted in the year 2006 under regulation 53B, but still it was not having any value. The reason behind, though Chartered Accountant Act permitted that yes, you can make partnership with CS, ICWA, actuarial valuer, but Companies Act 1956 was asking within the qualification of auditor that in case of a firm of auditor, all partner must be CA in practice. So virtually, though Chartered Accountant Act was permitting, Companies Act was not permitting, and that's why this regulation 53B was not having any value. Afterwards, Companies Act was amended in the year 2013. And in section 141, now it is being permitted that in a firm of chartered accountant, majority should be CA in practice. Earlier, all partners must be CA in practice and now majority should be CA in practice. And that's why now regulation 53B is in application after 2013, though it was introduced in the year 2006. Now it can be a firm where 6 partners are there, out of which 4 are chartered accountant in practice, 1 is CS and 1 is ICWA. If you are knowing about Companies Act regulation, section 141 bracket 1 and 2, 1 is saying that in a partnership firm, majority should be CA in practice and 2 is saying only CA partner can act and sign. One more point, that in case of a partnership firm, it can be a partnership in a form of LLP as well. A chartered accountant firm can create LLP, provided all partners are natural person. We have seen that XYZ and company, earlier it was a name, now it is XYZ and company LLP. As and when you are forming an LLP, you need to have a suffix of LLP at the end. So you are writing XYZ and company LLP. So basically, clause 4, part 1, first schedule. We know that part 1 is applicable to CA in practice, is talking about with whom we can make the partnership, within India with 2 and in abroad with 3. Within India with CA in practice and other professionals permitted within regulation 53B, and in abroad with 3, whoever is being permitted within section 4, subsection 1, clause 5, that is a basic Indian chartered account and staying abroad, whoever is being permitted by central government and whoever is being permitted by the council. Now with this particular clause, if we see the practicals related with the same, the practical number 1 is talking about a chartered accountant in practice in India enters into partnership with a certified public accountant in New York. And in such case, the members concerned take the profits earned in their own country. Will it make any difference if an Indian chartered accountant is practicing outside India and becomes a partner with the aforesaid accountant? Now, in this particular question, there are two, three things which I want to convey. Number one, this question is asking, can an Indian chartered accountant make partnership with CPA? CPA is not of USA. They are having CPA state-wise. Here it is written CPA of New York. There are 50 states in US. And they are not saying, the way in which we don't have chartered accountant of Maharashtra, chartered accountant of Rajasthan, we are having chartered accountants of India, but they are having CPA from New York, CPA from Texas, CPA from California. Now the question arises, can an Indian chartered accountant make partnership with CPA of New York or not? So far as clause 4 is concerned, it is not permitting. It is not permitting because we don't have any such bilateral tie-up, neither by our institute nor by our central government, and that's why a chartered accountant of India cannot have a partnership with a CPA of New York. Number one. Second part of this question is asking, suppose he was a permitted person. Suppose in that particular case, it is written in the question, you are just sharing the fees of your own country. Earlier there was a requirement that if you are making partnership in abroad, you had to share the fees of both the countries. Suppose I was making with a partnership who is staying in Australia and he was a permitted person. Earlier there was a requirement we had to share the fees of Australia as well as of India. But nowadays there is no such requirement. There is only one requirement that we need to make a partnership with a permitted person who is permitted under clause 4. There is no such further requirement that we had to share the fees of both the countries. The third part of the question where my view is differing from the view which is given in PM. Here it is written that once you are leaving India, can you make a partnership with someone who is a CPA in New York? The answer which is given in PM is saying, no, still you cannot make partnership with a person who is staying in New York. But I want to convey, this is my personal view which is differing with the view given in PM. The jurisdiction of Chartered Accountant Act given in Section 1, Chartered Accountant Act 1949 is applicable to all parts of India. Normally in all acts we are reading in this way, this act is applicable to all parts of India except Jammu and Kashmir. But so far as Chartered Accountant Act is concerned, it is also applicable in Jammu and Kashmir. And that's why Section 1 is saying that a Chartered Accountant Act is applicable to all parts of India. So my view is saying that if you are leaving India, this act is not following you, and afterwards you can make with partnership with a CPA in New York. Nothing is wrong, but still we need to follow the view which is given in PM and which is saying that wherever you go, you need to follow this particular clause 4, part 1, first schedule. At the same time, the next practical, if we see, Mr. Ram, a practicing chartered accountant from Rameswar, has entered into a partnership with Rahim, a practicing chartered accountant of a recognized professional body, for sharing fees of their partnership within India. Now, in this particular question, Rahim is a member of recognized professional body. He might be recognized either by the council or by the central government. As he is being a recognized person, definitely we can make partnership with him. Now the further question, what is written, that just to share the fees in India. As I recently said, earlier it was a requirement that you had to share the fees of both the countries when you were making partnership in abroad. But now there is no such requirement. There is only one requirement, that he should be a permitted person. And as it is mentioned in the question itself, that is a member of the recognized professional body. And that's why there is no violation of Clause 4, Part 1, First Schedule, just by sharing fees of India or just by sharing fees of abroad. It's only requirement that he should be a member of a recognized professional body, which is recognized either by central government or by council, and which is falling in a current case. The next one, if we see the question 3, Mr. John, a practicing chartered accountant, enter into partnership with Mr. Salim, a qualified chartered accountant holding certificate of practice as a cost accountant. A good question. Many of these questions you won't find anywhere, neither in RTP nor in PM. These are being very old questions. Why we are selecting this old question as well? Because you know this particular professional ethics is having weightage of 16 marks. We can't skip even a single question. And that's why we have selected question from all the areas. Now in this particular question, Salim is a chartered accountant as well as ICWA. But he is having COP of ICWA. Can we make partnership with him? Yes, definitely we can make partnership with him, because ICWA CMA is falling within regulation 53B, and 53B professionals with whom we can also make partnership in India. In India, we can make partnership with two, a CA in practice, as well as other professionals falling within regulation 53B, as he is falling within regulation 53B, and that's why he is a permitted person. Good question. He is a chartered accountant as well as ICWA, but holding COP of ICWA, and definitely we can make partnership with him. If we move to the next clause, clause 5. Clause 5 is talking about, you cannot generate work through wrong means and wrong person. Now there are two parts, wrong means, wrong person. Wrong person means a person with whom you cannot make a partnership. If I give you an example, suppose I appointed one agent in Mumbai who is generating work for me. He is making use of my firm name and I am sharing fees with him. Do you think that agent is the person with whom I can make a partnership? Not at all. So I generated work through wrong person, and that's why clause 5 will be attracted. As he made a use of my firm name, though he is not being a partner, and that's why clause 1 will be attracted. And afterwards I shared fees with him, that's why clause 2 will be attracted. Again I repeat, clause 1 was talking about, we cannot allow anyone to use our firm name except being a partner employee, provided employee is also CA in practice. Clause 2, with whom I can share my fees. Clause 3, with whose share fees I can share. Number 4, with whom I can make partnership within and outside India. And number 5, I cannot generate work through wrong means and wrong person. So I generated work from a person who is not eligible to be my partner, and that's why clause 5 will be attracted. He made use of my firm name, and that's why clause 1 will be attracted. And as I shared fees with him, and that's why clause 2 will be attracted. Now this is wrong person. What are wrong means? Wrong means are not specifically mentioned in clause 5, rather it is mentioned in clause 6 and 7. Basically clause 5, for which not a single question is given, neither in my book, nor in PM, nor in RTP, nor in module. And in past they have never ever asked any question related with clause 5, part 1, first schedule in ICAI's examination. Why it didn't happen? Because for wrong person, either clause 2, 3, 4 may be applied. And wrong means, clause 6 would be applied. So when there are specific clauses, no general question for clause 5 ever being asked in ICAI's examination. So let's move to the clause 6. Clause 6 is a very big clause. Maximum number of practicals we will find out in clause 6. Clause 6 is being asked almost in every examination. That shows the importance of this particular clause. Clause 6 is keeping 4 restrictions on us. A CA in practice cannot do advertisement, cannot issue circular, cannot make personal communication, and cannot appear for interview. Have you seen any advertisement hoarding of any chartered accountant? No, because it is being restricted under Clause 6, Part 1, First Schedule. As we know, Part 1 is applicable to CA in practice. Again, I repeat, clauses we are writing in numeric. Part 1, 2, 3, 4, we will write in Roman number. First Schedule, Second Schedule, we will write in words. Here, Clause 6 is keeping first restriction advertisement is strictly prohibited for a CA in practice. Second, personal communication. We cannot ask anyone to give us some work personally. Rather, we should generate our work by showing our skills. Number 3, we cannot issue circulars. Suppose some changes are there in GST or other income tax act. For public awareness, we cannot give in a newspaper various circulars. Yes, we can make client aware, but not the public aware. So circulars we cannot issue. And number 4, we cannot appear for interview. We are CA in practice. We are not CA in service. Suppose a particular company is thinking we want to appoint some auditors. And that's why we want to conduct interview of 3-4 auditors. And whoever is giving perfect answer, we will appoint them as the statutory auditor for the company. We can't appear for such interview because we are CA in practice. A CA in service can appear for the interview, but CA in practice cannot appear for the interview. So 4 basic restriction: advertisement, personal communication, appearing for interview, and circulars are strictly prohibited for the chartered accountant. But in the year 2006, they gave us 2 permission, which was earlier restricted. Number 1, a chartered accountant can ask another chartered accountant to allocate him some work on a profit sharing basis or on a partnership basis. Earlier, when I was studying, even chartered accountants were not allowed it to ask other chartered accountants because it was treated as personal communication. But later on, in the year 2006, amendment came, and afterwards it is being permitted that a chartered accountant in practice can ask another chartered accountant in practice to share some work with him on profit sharing basis or professional basis. And the second permission, which is being granted in the year 2006 when the act was amended, was responding to the tenders. Earlier, responding to the tenders were allowed it, but it was subject to many conditions. Now majority of the conditions are removed, and now freely we can respond to a tender. These 2 permissions are granted in the year 2006. A chartered accountant in practice ask another chartered accountant to share the fees. A chartered accountant in practice can ask another chartered accountant to share the work as well as responding to the tenders. In this particular clause, there are many additional points which we need to discuss. There are many practicals which we need to discuss. It is really important clause. The additional point number 1, advertisement can be given in a newspaper if there is a change in the firm name, if there is a change in the address, if there is a change in the partnership constitution. This advertisement can be given in a newspaper with a bare statement of fact and appropriateness to the area of circulation. You need to write in minimum words, number 1. And number 2, if your address is changing in Ahmedabad, you cannot give in the newspaper of Surat. So it's a first advertisement. Apparently advertisements are restricted, but it's a first advertisement which is being permitted, that you can give advertisement in a newspaper just to make public aware regarding the change in the firm name, address, or in the constitution. Provided bare statement of fact means you need to write minimum as well as appropriateness to the area of distribution. But suppose if you wish to communicate something exclusively to the chartered accountant and not to the public, we cannot give in the newspaper. Rather, it should be given in the ICIS journal as well as in the ICIS newsletters. Suppose I got some work from USA. I am not able to handle this work. I am searching some chartered accountant who can do this job for me, either on a profit sharing basis or on a partnership basis or on assignment basis. I am searching some chartered accountant. In such case, I cannot give newspaper advertisement because this is what I don't want to communicate to the public. Rather, I need to give it in the ICIS journal or in the ICIS newsletter. So, first advertisement which I wanted to communicate to the public was allowed in the newspaper. But second thing which I wanted to communicate only to the chartered accountant, that I can give in ICIS journal or newsletter. Number three, can we apply for the empanelment? Yes. What is the concept of empanelment? I want to say that the appointment by CAG in case of government company, as well as in case of banks, appointment of auditors are done through empanelment process, where they are maintaining the panel of auditors. They are keeping this panel open once in a year. As and when the panel is open, you can send your biodata, you can send your profile. And afterwards, it would be their decision to allocate you some audit work or not. So, you can apply for empanelment as and when the panel is open and you are aware that panel is maintained. In the mid of the year, at any point of time, if you are sending your biodata to the bank or CAG, that if panel is maintained, please consider my name, it would be treated as personal communication and it would be treated as violation of clause 6. You can apply for the empanelment provided you are aware panel is there and it is open, not otherwise. We are getting the audit work from CAG, from various banks through the process of empanelment, and they are keeping this panel open once in a year. We can apply provided we are aware panel is there and it is open, not otherwise. Now if you move to the fourth point, which is talking about having a name of chartered accountant and a telephone directory. In the era of mobile, now the telephone directory is of less use. Earlier there was a guideline to have our name included in the telephone directory. But in a recent one decade, they have not asked even a single question related with this. So we are not going to discuss much about it. But can we have our name included in the telephone directory? Yes, if it is open to all the chartered accountant. And we should not make any excessive payment. It should not be in a box. It should not be with a bold number. With these conditions, we can have our name included in the telephone directory. But as I said, in the era of mobile, it is of less use, and that's why even ICAI has not asked any question related with inclusion of name in a telephone directory in last one decade. If we move to the next point, which is next additional point, which is related with, can we write a book? Can we write an article? Yes. But as and when we are writing a book or we are writing an article, we can prescribe our name, we can write that we are a chartered accountant, we can write we are ACA, FCA, but we cannot write the firm name because we know that this book or this article would be circulated among the public. It would result into circulation, and that's why as and when you are writing a book, as and when you are writing an article, you can mention you are a chartered accountant, ACA, FCA, but at the same time, you cannot include the firm name. So where the firm name can be included, which is covered in the next point. If you have any religious ceremony at home, matrimonial ceremony, where the distribution of invitation card would be given only to your close friends and relatives, you can have your firm name as well, and it won't be treated as violation of clause 6. Basically, because they are already aware what is your firm name, who are you, what work you are doing, and that's why in case of such kind of invitation for religious ceremony or matrimonial ceremony at our place, if we are making the invitation card, we can include the firm name and nothing is wrong. The next point is talking about section 140 of the Companies Act 2013. We are knowing that a retiring auditor, as and when he is retiring, he can make a written representation. This opportunity is given to the retiring auditor under Companies Act to make a written representation. But all of us must have learned at intermediate IPCC level, while making such written representation, care should be taken, it should not result into a needless publicity. If it is resulting into a needless publicity of diffamatory matters, in that particular case, it will violate clause 6. He should just mention about his association with the company, how, what was his experience, but he should not clearly mention that I would like to continue in this particular company if I am being appointed once again. If he is mentioning any such thing, there may be certain criteria under Companies Act, but at the same time, clause 6 will be attracted. So clause 6 is saying that being a retiring auditor, this point would become applicable only when you are being a company auditor. When you are retiring, you need to make a written representation, and as and when you are making a written representation, you need to be careful. If you are not taking this care, you are making violation of clause 6 part 1 for schedule. The next point is talking about, suppose government is making some changes in GST, in income tax, in Companies Act. So you cannot draft a circular for its distribution in a newspaper among the public. Let the government to make public aware. Your job is just to make your clients aware. If you are giving such circulation to the client, nothing is wrong. But if you are giving it to the public, ultimately what will happen? It will result into circulation and it will violate clause 6, part 1, first schedule. The next point is talking about that you cannot give a clear cut advertisement in a newspaper that I am doing work of audit, I am doing work of income tax, I am doing work of company law, GST. This is my firm name, and if you want to give some work to me, I can do it at a reasonable rate. If I am giving such kind of advertisement, in that case it would be treated as a pure violation of clause 6, part 1, first schedule. At the same time, the next point is talking about that sometimes it is happening that some chartered accountant is referring my name. Suppose someone is handling the work of audit X, and his client is asking that you also do the work of income tax. Now at that time X is saying that better you go with Y, he is having a better experience and understanding of income tax work. So in that particular case, Y is getting work because of the reference of X. In such a case, Mr. Y should not snatch the original professional work of Mr. X, and that is the work of audit. Why, while handling the assignment of income tax, ask that client what fees being charged by Mr. X for the audit work? That client said 10,000 rupees. Mr. Y said, you come with me, I will do it at the amount of 3,000. Before the act was amended, undercutting of fees was prohibited. Means what? If a chartered accountant, a previous chartered accountant was charging 15,000 for taking that assignment, we were not in a position to charge 10,000 because it was treated as undercutting of fees. But from the year 2006, undercutting of fees is permitted. But this particular point is saying you should not take the original professional work of a chartered accountant who introduced you. So the person who is handling income tax assignment, whose name was referred by Mr. X, that particular chartered accountant Mr. Y should not snatch the work of Mr. X, otherwise he is subject to clause 6, part 1, first schedule. At the same time, the next point is talking about, many a time chartered accountants are giving interview in a print media or electronic media. As and when they are giving such kind of interviews, they need to be careful. What care? Specifically at the time of budget, there are panel discussions in the TV as well as in the newspaper, they are giving their comments. Care need to be taken that they should not speak their firm name. If they speak their firm name, they can say that they are a chartered accountant, they are ACA, they are FCA, but they should not speak the firm name because they are on a public domain. And where public in this process, if they are saying their firm name, ultimately it will go in a public domain and it will result into an advertisement. So care need to be taken while giving such interview either in a print media or in an electronic media. The next point is talking about various chartered accountant association or various societies are maintaining database of chartered accountants. Even various religious or social communities are also maintaining chartered accountants. Suppose a Brahmin society is maintaining database of the doctors and the chartered accountants. Can we have our name included within that? Yes, we can have our name included if we belong to that particular community. So if a chartered accountant association is also maintaining a directory or register of various chartered accountants of Mumbai, of Ahmedabad, of Baroda, we can have our name included within and it won't be treated as violation of clause 6. The next point is related with the guidelines of website. It is falling in clause 6 only. Can a CA firm have a website? Yes, they can have their own website, but subject to guidelines prescribed by ICAI. And if you make a violation of these guidelines, it would be treated as violation of clause 6. Within clause 6, you need to keep in mind, we are learning two guidelines. One earlier, that was of telephone directory. But as I said, now it is outdated. एंड सेकेंड दैट इज ऑफ वेबसाइट विच इज रीसेंट विच इज पॉपुलर एंड फ्रीक्वेंटली दे आस्क क्वेश्चंस आउट ऑफ दिस एरिया एंड दैट्स व्हाई दिस गाइडलाइन इज रियली इंपॉर्टेंट. द गाइडलाइन नंबर वन दैट यू कैन यूज एनी कलर्स. सो इवन एट्रैक्टिव कलर्स कैन बी यूज फॉर मेकिंग द वेबसाइट ऑफ अ सीए फर्म. इवन ब्लैक एंड व्हाइट वेबसाइट वोंट लुक गुड. सेकेंड the information given, the prescribed information given should be with a pull technology and not with a push technology. These are the IT terms, but I want to convey in a pull technology, if you specify that particular button, then only the information will come out. Like suppose nature of services provided, if it is written on a website, if I push that particular button, then only the data will come out. It should not automatically blink. And that's why your website should be with a pull technology and it should not be with the push technology. The next point, that the information on the website cannot be circulated by drafting email to all. It is not being permitted. You created a very good website, but there were less users, so you drafted a mail out of it and ultimately you are circulating this mail. It is not being permitted. Plus, you can also mention your website address on your professional documents, stationaries, visiting card, letterheads. It is being permitted. Moreover, what information can be given on website? On the website, we can mention the firm name, year of establishment. You remember, year of establishment can be mentioned on a website, but it cannot be mentioned on a visiting card or the letterhead. Again, I repeat, year of establishment can be mentioned on a website, but it cannot be mentioned on visiting card or the letterhead. Member's address, fax number, email ID, nature of services provided with a pull request. As I said, if I press the button, then only the data should come out. Who are the partners, details of employee, job vacancies available, number of article clerk, nature of assignment handle. But what cannot be given, names of the client and fees charged cannot be given. I repeat, names of the client and fees charged cannot be given. At the same time, we cannot use logo on a website. But you remember, we can make use of logo on visiting card as well as letterhead. Which logo? Alphabet of trust. That can be used on visiting card and letterhead, but it cannot be used on a website. So logo is not being permitted on a website, but it is being permitted on a visiting card letterhead. Whereas reverse, year of establishment is being permitted on a website, but it is not being permitted on a letterhead and visiting card. At the same time, passport size photograph can have on a website. It should not be a full size photograph, but it should be a passport size photograph of partners can be there on a website. Nothing is wrong. Plus, if any articles are there, plus professional communications you want to convey, plus a good article or write-up if someone has prepared, it can be uploaded on a website if it is of a professional use, and that's why there is nothing wrong. It can be there on a website. Plus chat room and bulletin board can be provided. Chat room, yes. Chatting is not a social chatting, but the chatting with the client and chatting with the other members on the professional's issue is being permitted through website. Moreover, online advice can be provided to the client. If the client is at a distance place and is not able to communicate with you on a regular basis, online advice can be provided to the client with fees or without fees. Plus, your name can be there on a suitable search engine. If someone is searching on Google that chartered accountant firms in Ahmedabad and or in Mumbai, and if your firm name is there, in that particular case, nothing is wrong. Your firm name as well as your website name can be there on a suitable search engine. At the same time, it should not contain any material which is soliciting client or which is soliciting professional work. This care need to be taken as and when you are drafting or you are creating a website. Moreover, your website became very popular. There are very many visitors of this website. In that particular case, you cannot have any advertisement. Advertisement of Swiggy, advertisement of Pepsi cannot be there on your website. It is not being permitted. At the same time, from our website, we can have a different links. Link of ICAI, link of regional branches of ICAI, link of ICI Delhi. At the same time, RBI, SEBI, statutory body, we can give a link of website of various statutory bodies from our website. But you need to keep in mind, suppose you are being a president of any voluntary association, like All Ahmedabad Chartered Accountant Association. It's a voluntary association and you are being a president of it. And they also have their own website, Chartered Accountant Association. From website of your firm, there cannot be a link of the website of that voluntary association. So you need to keep in mind, from your website, there can be a link of the statutory bodies and not of the voluntary association. Plus, your website name, web address should match with your firm name or with the name of the partners. Suppose your firm name is XYZ and Company. Your web address cannot be www.abc.com because ABC doesn't match with your firm name or it doesn't match with the names of the partner. So you need to be careful when you are creating your website address. It should match with your firm name or with the name of the partners. At the same time, you need to mention on your website up to what date your website is being uploaded. Plus, various companies, various agencies in the era of internet, nowadays they are giving online services of taxation, of GST. To attract the client at that time, they can mention that this service is from their side being provided by a chartered accountant. But they cannot mention the name of the chartered accountant and they cannot also mention the name of the firm. Suppose some agency is there, www.taxservices.com. Now, what is the work done by that particular website? Whatever queries, whatever return you want to submit, whatever suggestion you want, they are giving online. But client would be attracted if and only if they mention that on their side services are being provided by a chartered accountant. So at that time they can just mention that this service is being provided by a chartered accountant, but they cannot mention the firm name and they cannot mention the name of the chartered accountant. This care need to be taken. Now we will move for the practical discussion. There are many practicals related with Clause 6. One by one we will see all the practical. Practical number 1, Mrs. XYZ, a firm in practice, develops a website xyz.com. The color chosen for the website was very bright green and the website was to run on a push technology where the names of the partner of the firm and the major clients were to be displayed on the website. Now for this particular question, I want to say two things they have done correct and two things they have done wrong. What is correct first of all? Correct thing, they can have any bright color for creating a website. Nothing is wrong. And they can also mention the name of the partners. It is also being permitted. What is wrong? It should not be on a push technology. Rather, it should be on a pull technology. And second thing, they cannot mention the name of the client. So mentioning the name of the client and running it on a pull technology would be treated as violation of guidelines of website. And guidelines of website we are learning within Clause 6. And that's why ultimately it would be treated as violation of Clause 6, Part 1, First Schedule. You need to keep in mind that within Clause 6, we are learning two guidelines. One is related with telephone directory, one is related with website. And any violation would be treated as violation of Clause 6, Part 1, First Schedule. So in a first practical, our answer would be that firm would be held responsible. Now the second question that emerged to mind, that in that particular firm there are three partners, X, Y and Z. Who would be held responsible? Mr. X created this website. Y and Z are partners. Still the entire firm and all partners will be held responsible under Clause 6, Part 1, First Schedule. It's not like that in our firm Mr. X created a website and he committed a mistake and that's why he should be only held responsible. Rather, the entire firm and all partners will be held responsible. If we move to the second question, Mrs. XYZ, a firm of chartered accountant, created a website www.xyzindia.com. The website, besides containing details of the firm and bio data of the partner, also contain the photograph of all the partners of the firm. So far as this question is concerned, again it is related with the guidelines of website. And we know that within the guidelines it is being mentioned that you can mention the name of the partners as well as a passport size photograph of partners can be there on a website. Nothing is wrong. It won't be treated as violation of clause 6 part 1 for schedule. The next question, third practical, in a representation to be submitted to a company under section 140 of the Companies Act 2013, the partner of the firm of auditor wants to include the contribution made by the firm in the strengthening the control procedures of the company during their association with the company. Now, this question is again related with section 140 of Companies Act. It can become applicable only to the company auditor. We are knowing that as and when any auditor is retiring in a Companies Act, they are being given right to make a written representation. But while making such written representation, they need to be careful and they should not include anything which is bringing needless publicity of defamatory matters. In this particular question, he mentioned what efforts he made for strengthening the control procedures and it would be circulated among all shareholders of the company. We are knowing it well in a Companies Act, if the time is permitting, then this representation is being circulated among all the members. But if the time is not permitting, then it would be read out on the date of AGM. So anyhow, it will be in the notice of the shareholders and that's why in a current case, it will lead to advertisement. He indicated what efforts he made for the purpose of strengthening the control procedures and that's why it would be treated as violation of clause 6, part 1, first schedule. The next question. A partner of a firm of chartered accountant during a TV interview handed over a biodata of his firm to the chairperson. Such biodata detailed the standing of the international firm with which the firm was associated. It also detailed the achievement of the concerned partner and his recognition as an expert in the field of taxation in the country. The chairperson read out the said biodata during the interview. Now, in this particular case, we need to keep in mind a particular point related with giving public interview. Be it be in a print media or electronic media, you need to be careful. While giving such information, you cannot use the adjectives like experts in the taxation, experts in the industry, or in association with any international firm. If you are mentioning your firm name, it would be treated as violation of clause 6, part 1, first schedule. In a current case, it's a clear violation of clause 6, part 1, first schedule, and that's why that chartered accountant. Now, you can say that the details were read out by the person who was taking this interview, but details were provided by a chartered accountant. The person who was reading out, the chairperson who was reading out it, was simply reading out the details which are being provided by a chartered accountant. So he's not at a fault. The fault is on the part of the chartered accountant and where he would be held responsible under clause 6, part 1, first schedule. The next question related with this clause 6, a young chartered accountant in practice who did her articles under a senior chartered accountant write to him with a request to divert some of the surplus work to her on a profit sharing basis. Now, this point is related with the exception. We learn in clause 6 that four things are prohibited for us: advertisement, personal communication, interview and circular. But in 2006, they gave us two permissions, which were also restrictions earlier. Number one, a chartered accountant can ask another chartered accountant to allocate some work on a profit sharing or assignment basis. And number two, we can respond to the tender. So in a current case, Abhaya is asking some senior chartered accountant to allocate some work on a profit sharing or assignment basis. And it won't be treated as a violation of clause 6 part 1 first schedule because it is falling within the exception. You need to keep in mind that this exceptions normally we are writing as and when it is being asked. It's being a part of original structure. As I mentioned earlier, when you are writing your answer would be in a two part. First part would be clause itself and second part would be correlation with that clause. Suppose if we talk about a previous question that was related with a TV interview. In that particular question, we should not mention about asking some chartered accountant to allocate the work or responding to the tenders, though it is being a part of the original structure of the clause, where we should keep ourselves restricted for four things: advertisement, circulars, public interview, and personal communication. We should not further mention in that particular clause that provided nothing shall disentitle a chartered accountant from requesting some other chartered accountant to allocate some work on a professional or assignment basis or responding to the tender. These two things means after the word provided, you should mention if and only if being asked in the question. So far as this question is concerned, I want to clarify that 2006 onwards, after the amendment, one chartered accountant can ask another chartered accountant to allocate the work on a professional basis or assignment basis. The next question, if we see, a letter is sent by a chartered accountant to the Ministry of Finance inquiring whether a panel of auditor is being maintained by the ministry, and if it is so, to include his name in the panel. This question is related with the concept of empanelment. If I just give you a little bit revision about that concept, many a time such kind of work is not there wherever we are doing articles. If we may not be aware of this kind of situation, you are getting certain audit through the empanelment. Empanelment of bank, empanelment of CAG, they are maintaining panel and they are giving the work only through the process of empanelment. These panels they are keeping open once in a year, and as and when the panel is open, you can apply. But in the mid of the year, at any point of time, you cannot send your biodata that if panel is there and if it is open, please include my name. If you are giving it in this way, it would be treated as roving inquiry, it would be treated as personal communication, and it would be treated as violation of Clause 6, Part 1, First Schedule. So if you are aware that panel is there and it is open, you can send your biodata, not otherwise. In a current case, he randomly sent his biodata, and that's why it would be treated as violation of Clause 6, Part 1, First Schedule. Next question is related with Mr. X, a practicing chartered accountant, give an advertisement under the column business and professional of a local newspaper offering part-time secretarial work. I can say it's a pure case of advertisement. You cannot give in the newspaper that I am doing the work of audit, I am doing the work of GST, I am doing the work of income tax with your firm name, or I am offering secretarial work, else it would be treated as clear advertisement and it would be treated as violation of Clause 6, Part 1, First Schedule. At this point, I want to convey that when you are writing first paragraph, you are writing the clause itself, and where you will also mention about advertisement, personal communication, interview and circular. But when you are writing the second paragraph, you are correlating that clause with the particular question. In that correlation, you need to exactly mention whether it is an advertisement, whether it is a personal communication, whether it is circular or what. In fact, in this particular question, I can say in a first paragraph, we will write the clause itself. And when we are writing the clause itself, we are mentioning all advertisement, personal communication, interview, circular. But when we are writing the second paragraph, we will clearly mention that here Mr. X has done advertisement and that's why he is subject to Clause 6, Part 1, First Schedule. You can't write as Mr. X has done personal communication, as Mr. X has issued circular. You need to specifically mention what he has done in the second paragraph, that he has done advertisement and that's why he will be held guilty of negligence of his professional duties under Clause 6, Part 1, First Schedule. The next question, what is the nature of misconduct in following cases? If we move to question 8, Mrs. Harilal and Associate, a firm of chartered accountant, have authorized Biharilal, who is also a chartered accountant, to accept and carry out audit of educational institution on its behalf. Without the knowledge of firm, Biharilal issued circular to various schools and colleges that they would be willing to accept and carry out their audit at a reasonable fees. In this particular question, I want to explain, the assignment was received by Harilal Associate, but they might be overburdened, so they outsourced this work to Biharilal. Can it be outsourced to some chartered accountant? Yes, nothing is wrong. But while Biharilal was handling this work, he came to know such kind of assignment he can also get from the schools and various colleges. So instead of doing the work of Harilal and company, better I should directly approach the school and colleges and accordingly approach the schools and colleges by writing a letter. As he has written a letter for demanding the work, it would be treated as personal communication and it would be treated as violation of Clause 6, part 1 first schedule. Again, I want to communicate, when you are writing the first clause, you will mention all four: advertisement, personal communication, circular, and appearing for interview. But in a second paragraph, so far as this question is concerned, I want to convey, you need to specifically mention, this is not the advertisement, this is personal communication, and because of that, he will be held guilty of negligence of his professional duties under clause 6, part 1, first schedule. Next question, if we see, a junior chartered accountant in practice requests in writing to a senior member of his profession who is overburdened with the professional work to divert some of his senior member's work to him on a profit sharing basis. Is there any offense in seeking professional work by a member from another member? Give reasons for your answer. This kind of question we saw earlier. It was a question of Abhaya. She was asking the senior chartered accountant to allocate the work. And we know that 2006 onward, this is being the exception, where it is being permitted that one chartered accountant can ask another chartered accountant to share the work on professional basis, profit sharing basis, and it won't be treated as personal communication, and it won't be treated as violation of clause 6, part 1, first schedule. If we see the next question, whether you can respond to World Bank's global tender of carrying out the audit assignment in England. This is a good question. Again, it is related with the exception. We know that the basic structure of clause 6 is talking about advertisement, personal communication, appearing for interview, and circulars are prohibited. But at the same time, two things were permitted. 2006 amendment. First, we can ask some chartered accountant to allocate some work to us, and second, we can respond to the tender. Earlier, there were many conditions to respond to the tenders. All conditions being removed, they have kept it free to respond to the tender. But in case of global tender, still there is one condition: your fees should be in foreign currency. So in a current case, when you are responding to the tender, there is nothing wrong, it's not a violation of clause 6, but at the same time, you need to make sure in case of global tender, the fees should be received in a foreign currency. Now again, I want to communicate. Here we will not only write about the original structure, advertisement, personal communication, interview and circular, but we will have to further mention, provided that nothing shall disentitle a chartered accountant from responding to the tender. Because this question is related with tender. If it is related with the tender, we need to specifically mention about the tender while writing the first paragraph, while writing the clause itself. So in a current case, responding to the tender is not a violation and it won't be treated as violation of clause 6, part 1, first schedule, provided fees are received in a foreign currency. If we move to the next question, Mr. S, a chartered accountant, published a book and gave his personal detail as the author. These details also mention his professional experience and his present association as a partner with Mrs. RSTF firm. Writing a book or article is freely permissible, no restriction as such. But while you are writing a book or article, you need to be careful. You can mention your name, you can mention you are a chartered accountant, you can mention ACA, FCA, but you cannot mention the firm name, because this book or article will not remain with you only, rather it would be circulated among the public and they will come to know about what is your firm name. And that's why writing the firm name while writing book or article is strictly prohibited. It would be treated as violation of clause 6, part 1, first schedule. So in a current case, chartered accountant would be held guilty of negligence of his professional duties under clause 6, part 1, first schedule. If we see the next question, XYZ and associate, a firm with 5 partners, develop a website www.xyzassociate.com. The website also contain a link to All India Chartered Accountant Association, a voluntary association where Mr. X, a partner of the firm, is currently the vice president. You remember, while learning the guidelines of a website, we clearly learn, when you are creating a website, from your website, there can be a link to ICI, its regional branches, statutory bodies, but there cannot be a link to any voluntary association. Here in current case, he might be a president of that particular chartered accountant association, but it's a voluntary association, and that voluntary association created a website. Now from your firm's website, there cannot be a link to the website of that voluntary association. Otherwise, it would be violation of guidelines of website, and ultimately it would violate clause 6, part 1, for schedule of Chartered Accountant Act. So in a current case, as link is given from your website to the website of the link of voluntary association, it would be treated a clear violation of clause 6 part 1 first schedule. Next question. Messrs. LMN, a firm of chartered accountant, responded to a tender from a state government for computerization of land revenue records. For this purpose, the firm also paid 50,000 as earnest deposit as a part of the term of the tender. Now, again, this question is related with responding to the tender, and we know it very well. Responding to the tender is freely permissible from 2006 onwards. Now, within the terms of the tender, it was being a requirement to pay amount of 50,000 as earnest deposit. This deposit may be refundable, may not be refundable. Now, it is not being paid only by that particular chartered accountant. It would be paid by all chartered accountants, whoever is applying for that particular tender. And if it is within the terms of the tender, nothing wrong in paying such kind of deposit. And that's why we are responding to the tender and we are paying the earnest deposit will not attract clause 6 part 1 first schedule. There is no violation of clause 6 part 1 first schedule in a current case. If we see the next question, a chartered accountant in practice created his own website in attractive format and colors and circulated the information contained in the website through email. You might observe out of many previous questions, majority of the questions were related with website. It is being very popular in ICI and they are frequently asking questions out of this area, and that's why we need to be careful. Clause 6 is very popular, and even within clause 6, the questions related with website very popular. We learn you created a website, very attractive website, but the users were less, and that's why what you did, you created an email and all the information of website you carried to the email, and then after you send this email to all. In that particular case, it will be treated as a clear violation of clause 6 part 1 first schedule, because it's a violation of guidelines of website. Again, I want to repeat that here under clause 6, we are discussing two guidelines. One is of a telephone directory and one is of website. There is not a single question related with telephone directory, but there are many questions related with website, and any question of website, violation of guidelines of website, would violate clause 6, part 1, first schedule. If we see the next question, an advertisement was published in a newspaper containing the photograph of Mr. X, a member of the institute, wherein he was congratulated on the occasion of the opening ceremony of his office. Here it would be treated as a clear violation of advertisement. You started an office. Many chartered accountants are starting their own practice and they are starting the office. They are starting office of 1,000 square feet or 2,000 square feet. They are inviting their guests. They are inviting their relatives. They are inviting their friends, clients also. But they cannot give newspaper advertisement for congratulating that particular chartered accountant for starting an office. What will happen if such kind of congratulation is being given? It will come into the knowledge of entire city, wherever that newspaper is being circulated, that there is a CA firm which is working here, and it would lead to clear advertisement. Now, it is quite possible that chartered accountant may not be aware he is starting office, and his relative, out of enthusiasm, without the knowledge of chartered accountant, may give advertisement in a newspaper to give him surprise. But this surprise may create a big trouble for that chartered accountant. And that's why you need to be careful. None of your relative should give advertisement on behalf of you or for congratulating you on in case of starting of office or for any achievement with a firm name, else it would be treated as a clear violation of clause 6 part 1 first schedule. So you need to be very careful so far as this matter is concerned, and in this particular case, it's a clear violation, it's a clear advertisement, clause 6 part 1 first schedule would be attracted. Move to the next question. A special notice has been issued for a resolution at the 3rd annual general meeting of UD Limited, providing expressly CA Smart shall not be reappointed as an auditor of the company. Consequently, CA Smart submitted a representation in writing to the company as provided under section 140 bracket 4 bracket 3 of the Companies Act 2013. In the representation, CA Smart incorporated his independent working as a professional throughout the term of office and also indicated his willingness to continue as an auditor if reappointed by the shareholders of the company. Now again, this question is related with section 140 of Companies Act, and we know that this would become applicable only in case of company auditor. This is the opportunity given to the retiring auditor, and he is being allowed it to make a written representation. If this representation is received well in time, it would be circulated among shareholder. If it is being received late, it would be read out on the date of AGM. Here he should be careful that it should not result into needless publicity of defamatory matter. So far as this question is concerned, my personal view is differing with the view which is given in PM. In PM, for this particular question, it is being mentioned there is nothing wrong if you ask in your representation, I would be happy to continue if I am being reappointed. So accordingly, as per the answer of PM, we are taking a view that so far as this question is concerned, it won't be treated as a violation of clause 6 part 1 first schedule. But if someone asks me personally, I am of the opinion here it's a clear violation of clause 6 part 1 first schedule, because in your representation you clearly mention that if I am being reappointed, I would wish to continue, and that's what a violation of clause 6 part 1 first schedule. But so far as this question is concerned, if it is being asked in exam, as per the answer of PM, you will have to mention that there is no misconduct and clause 6 part 1 first schedule won't be violated. If we move to the next question, CA UB and CA PB are two partners of the firm CA firm Sono Mono and Associate. Being very religious, CA PB organized a religious ceremony at his home, for which he instructed his printing agent to add his designation chartered accountant with his name in the invitation card. Later on, the invitation were distributed to all the relatives, close friends and clients of both the partners. This question is a bit tricky. Earlier we learned we can mention our firm name when we are having some religious or matrimonial ceremony at our place. We can mention the name of the firm and nothing is wrong, because these cards would be circulated among friends and close relative. Now, I want to explain this particular question. Suppose there is a firm A and associate, one more firm B and associate, and third partnership firm, that is AB and associate. Now, Mr. A is having religious ceremony at his place, and in case of religious ceremony at the place of Mr. A, he can give invitation card to his close friends, his relatives, his clients of A and associate, his clients of AB and associate, but he cannot give invitation card to the close friends, relatives and clients, individual clients of B and associates. Again, I want to repeat, there are two proprietorship firm, one partnership firm, and both the proprietors are partner at that particular place, out of which Mr. A is having religious ceremony at his home, and where he is inviting his friends, his clients, his relatives, nothing wrong. He is inviting the clients of a partnership firm, nothing wrong. But he can't invite. He can invite, but while inviting, he cannot have the name of his firm mentioned within that invitation card when he is sending to the clients, friends and close relative of Mr. B. And that's what a violation in current case. In a current case, here the person who kept the religious ceremony, he invited his own friends and relatives and clients, as well as the clients, relatives and friends of his partner, which are being a part of his individual proprietorship firm. And that's why in this particular case, it would be treated as violation of clause 6, part 1, first schedule. Clause 6, part 1, first schedule. Clauses we are writing always in numeric, part 1, 2, 3, 4, Roman number. First schedule, second schedule, we are always writing in words. If we move to the next question, CA PB, a chartered accountant in practice, provided part-time tutorship under the coaching organization of the institute. On 30th June 2015, he was awarded best faculty of the year as a gratitude from the institute. Later on, CA PB posted his frame photograph on his website, wherein he was receiving the said award from the institute. Now basically, if we remember the guidelines of the website in which it was being mentioned that passport size photograph can be mentioned on a website, nothing is wrong. You remember, passport size photograph can be mentioned on a website, but it cannot be mentioned on a visiting card or the letterhead. Year of establishment can be mentioned on the website, but it cannot be mentioned on visiting card and letterhead. At the same time, logo cannot be mentioned on a website, but it can be mentioned on a letterhead and the visiting card. So far as this question is concerned, on a website, he is not putting his passport size photograph, rather he is putting a frame photograph regarding the congratulation award received, gratitude award received from the institute, and which is not being allowed it. It would be treated as violation of guidelines of website, and ultimately it would lead to violation of Clause 6, Part 1, First Schedule. Moving to the next question. CAPB in practice started project consultancy work as a part of his practice and to advance the same sent mail to all chartered accountants in the country informing them of his services and for securing professional work. To some extent, even my opinion would differ in this case with PM and suggested answer. Apparently, it seems here one chartered accountant is making communication with another chartered accountant. And from 2006 onwards, it is from the amendment, it is being allowed that one chartered accountant can ask another chartered accountant to share the work on a professional basis or otherwise. But so far as this question is concerned, though we will keep the answer what is given in suggested, and as per suggested answer, it is being mentioned that one CA is asking another CA, he can ask orally, he can ask by letter, or he can also ask by email. Nothing is wrong. But you are asking chartered accountants which are unknown to you. And across the nation, whoever is a chartered accountant, you are sending the email that these are the services provided by me. Apparently, my personal opinion, it seems to be a violation of Clause 6, Part 1, First Schedule. But we need to follow the answer, what is given in suggested, what is given in PM, and which is clearly indicating that a chartered accountant can ask another chartered accountant to share the work on a profit-sharing basis and professional basis, and nothing is wrong as per Clause 6. So there is no violation of Clause 6, Part 1, First Schedule. Now, the next clause, which is related with Clause 7, really important clause. Clause 7 is talking about two things. A chartered accountant in practice cannot use any designation other than chartered accountant unless it is being a degree given by any university established by law or any designation approved by ICAI. So accordingly, BCom, MCom, PhD, such kind of designation chartered accountant can use? Yes, because it is being permitted, because it is being the degree given by any university established by law. In a similar way, he can also use the designation like CS, ICWA, because it is being permitted by ICAI. These are being the institutions established in India. So what kind of designation we can't use? We cannot use the designation like tax consultant, cost consultant, management consultant. Such kind of designation is not being given neither by any university nor by any approved institution. This is the first part of this particular clause. This clause is keeping first restriction that a chartered accountant in practice cannot use any designation other than chartered accountant unless it be a degree of any university established by law, or second, it is being any degree which is being given by any approved institution. The second part of this clause is saying he cannot disclose his professional achievements. He can't write on a professional document anywhere, senior most in the profession, expert in taxation, such kind of adjectives which indicate his superiority in comparison with other chartered accountants is being strictly prohibited under Clause 7. So Clause 7 is talking about two things. Number one, that you cannot use any designation other than chartered accountant unless it be a degree of university or approved institution. And second, you cannot disclose your professional achievement. These two are strictly prohibited under Clause 7. If we read Clause 7 further, there are certain additional points. One by one, we need to see all the points. Many questions would be a combination of Clause 6 and 7, which we will study within the practicals of Clause 7. The way in which we had a practical of 2 and 3 combined, Clause 2 and 3 combined in Clause 3 itself. In a similar way, many practicals will face, which is a combination of Clause 6 and Clause 7 both. In a current case, Clause 7, if we see the additional information, year of establishment cannot be given on a visiting card. That indicates your seniority. Year of establishment cannot be given on a visiting card, or it cannot be given on a letterhead. Yes, it can be given on the website. So number one, year of establishment cannot be given since 1969, since 1980, cannot be mentioned on the visiting card and the letterhead. At the same time, we cannot use the designation like tax consultant, cost consultant, management consultant, because such kind of designations are not being given neither by any university nor by any approved institution. Third, as I said earlier, that passport size photograph can be there on a website, but you cannot have passport size photograph neither on visiting card nor on the letterhead. This is not being allowed. It. Number four, success if you have in any examination, like you got the rank, you can mention it throughout your life, because when you got the rank, it was your student's life. It wasn't your professional achievement. It was your personal achievement, and professional achievement can be there once you enter into profession. It was your personal achievement, and personal achievement can be mentioned. And that's why if you have got the rank in intermediate, final, foundation level, you can mention it throughout your life and nothing is wrong. It won't be treated as disclosure of professional achievement. One more point if we speak about MP, MLA, such kind, or municipal councillor. Suppose if you become a municipal councillor, MP, MLA, this designation you cannot use along with CA on a same visiting card or letterhead if you are a CA in practice, because this kind of designation like member of parliament or member of legislative assembly or municipal councillor is neither given by any university nor given by any approved institution. So what should I do in that particular case? You should make two different cards. One card where you are showing yourself as a chartered accountant in practice, and second card where you are showing yourself as MP or MLA, but on a same visiting card you cannot designate yourself as a chartered accountant in practice along with MP, MLA or municipal councillor. At the same time, you can be a director of a company. Nothing is wrong. Without taking prior approval of council, you can be a director of a company. I'm not talking about MD. I'm talking about a director. Nothing wrong. You can be a director of a company. Now, suppose you are being a director of a particular company and company is issuing a prospectus. As and when company is issuing a prospectus, company is creating a rosy picture. Company is showing the prospects of the company. And while creating rosy picture about the company, they will write many good things about the directors. That director is this and director is that, and that would be circulated. Prospectus will not remain with the company, rather it would be circulated in a public, and that's why you need to be careful. The company won't be careful because company is not aware of this professional ethics. Rather, you should be careful because you are a chartered accountant in practice, you are being a director of a company, your name is included in a prospectus, and while your name is included in a prospectus, at that particular time, if they are writing about your professional achievement and if it is being circulated among the public, it would be treated not only as a violation of clause 7, it would be also treated as violation of clause 6. And that's why your name can be included in a prospectus, nothing wrong, but there should not be any disclosure of the professional achievement. At the same time, outside our office, we cannot have signboard with a glow sign or with the light. It should be a formal, normal, and it should match with the appropriate of the office space. It should not be a big hoarding on the terrace which anyone can see from a distance. It should be a small size, it should be matching with your office space, and it should not be the glow or light sign. We need to be careful that outside our office, whenever we are mentioning, whenever we are specifying our firm name on a signboard, it should not be with a glow sign, it should not be with a light, and it should match with the appropriateness of the office space. At the same time, a CA firm cannot develop their own logo. Like if you can find out logo of Reliance, that is R. In a similar way, Tata. These are the logos which are being developed by a company. But a CA firm cannot develop their own logo. They need to make use of logo of ICI only. What does it mean? Logo means that logo of Eagle? Not at all. Logo of Eagle is the constitutional symbol of ICI that cannot be used by a chartered accountant. But logo of Alphabet of Trust. And that logo of Alphabet of Trust can be used on a visiting card and letterhead, but it cannot be used on the website. So we need to be careful that it cannot be there on our website. It can be there, and it should not be that eagle, because that's a constitutional symbol. At the same time, chartered accountant can have outside his residence his name with a tag chartered accountant, ACA or FCA, but he cannot mention the firm name. If he is mentioning the firm name outside the residence,
that residence would be treated as a branch and section 27 of Chartered Accountant Act 1949 related with branch, all provisions will become applicable. So outside your residence, you can mention your name, ACA, FCA, Chartered Accountant, but you can't mention the firm name. If you are mentioning the firm name, it would be treated as a branch and provisions of branch would become applicable to you. So the next additional point is talking about, in clause 6, we learn advertisement is restricted. Very strange, few advertisements are permitted, but not under clause 6, under clause 7. And that advertisements are permitted subject to guideline. And that guideline is known as guideline of write-up. Again, I want to repeat. Clause 6 was restricting advertisement. Clause 7 is permitting advertisement. There are three advertisements which are being permitted for us. And this advertisement is subject to guidelines of write-up. I want to give you a reminder. In clause 6, we learn guidelines of telephone directory and guidelines of website. Any violation would be treated as violation of clause 6. In a similar way, under clause 7, there is a guidelines of write-up. And any violation would be treated as violation of clause 7, not of 6. So strange thing, advertisement was restricted in clause 6, but few advertisements are permitted in clause 7, subject to guidelines of write-up. Three advertisements are permitted for us. Number one, recruiting staff in our own office. In a newspaper, we always find that recruiting staff in our own office, we are always giving advertisement. Nothing is wrong. A CA firm can give advertisement. Number two, recruiting staff in the client's office or purchasing or disposing of properties on behalf of client. That is also permissible. Such kind of advertisement can be given with the name of CA firm on behalf of client. It can be given. And number three, for disposing of any property in a capacity of trustee, liquidator or receiver. These three advertisement can be given. Again, I repeat, recruiting staff in your own office, recruiting staff in the office of your client or disposing of properties on behalf of client. And third one, disposing of properties in a capacity of trustee, liquidator or receiver. This advertisement can be given subject to guidelines of write-up. But while giving such kind of advertisement, you should avoid the words like well-known firm or in association with. Such kind of adjectives should not be used while giving such kind of advertisement. You can't mention well-known firm wish to recruit chartered accountants and this would be the remuneration. So well-known firm or in association with, such kind of adjectives cannot be mentioned while you are giving advertisement in the newspaper. Now, one by one, we will see all the practicals related with clause 7. First practical, Z, a CA wrote several letters to the government department pointing out seniority of his firm, sending his life sketch and stating that he had a glorious record of service to the country as well as to the organization of accountancy profession with a view to get the audit work. In this particular case, I can tell you there are two clauses being violated. First of all, he is writing a letter. And as he is writing a letter, it would be treated as personal communication where clause 6 would be violated. And second, while writing the letter, he is clearly mentioning he is having a glorious record of working in the accountancy profession and sending the seniority and life sketch. This indicates disclosure of the professional achievement. And as disclosure of professional achievement is done, clause 7 would be attracted. As personal communication is made, clause 6 would be applicable, and as he indicated his professional achievement, so clause 7 would be attracted. So while writing the answer in the examination, you need to write word to word clause 6 first, then after clause 7, and then after the ultimate paragraph where you need to mention here a chartered accountant in practice has made a violation of clause 6 and clause 7 of part 1 of first schedule of Chartered Accountant Act 1949. The second question, if we see, the offer document of a listed company in which Mr. D, a practicing chartered accountant, is a director, mention the name of Mr. D as a director along with his various professional achievements and spheres of specialization. Now this question again, I want to say, being a CA in practice, can I be a director? Nothing is wrong. And I am not supposed to take even a prior approval of ICAI's counsel. But at the same time, when I am becoming a director and if company is issuing a prospectus, prospectus is a document which is showing the prospects of the company. And while showing the prospects of the company, you need to be careful. Your name would be included. And where they will create a rosy picture about the company, where they will also mention your achievement to attract the investor. Being chartered accountant in practice, you need to be careful and you need to clarify to the company, you can mention my name as a director, but you can't disclose the professional achievement, what I have gained. Otherwise, it would be treated not only of violation of clause 7, but also of clause 6, because this prospectus would be circulated among the investor, among the public, and that's why it would be treated as violation of clause 6, clause 7 of part 1 of first schedule of Chartered Accountant Act 1949. Next question. A practicing chartered accountant uses a visiting card in which he designates himself besides as chartered accountant, tax consultant and cost consultant. As we learned earlier, under clause 7 there are two restrictions, out of which the restriction number 1, a CA in practice cannot use any designation unless it be a degree given by any university established by law in India or it is being approved, any designation which is being approved by the ICAI. So accordingly, CS, ICWA, such kind of designation we can use, BCom, MCom we can use, but tax consultant, cost consultant, such kind of designation neither given by any university nor given by any approved institution, and that's why it cannot be used. If you are ICWA, mention yourself as ICWA, you can't mention yourself as cost consultant. As you mention yourself as tax consultant or cost consultant, it would be clearly treated as violation of clause 7, part 1, first schedule. Next question. What is the nature of misconduct, if any, in the following case? X and company chartered accountant informed selected a multinational organization who are not their client that Mr. Y, the former partner in charge of taxation of one of the largest accounting firm of the world, had joined the firm as a partner. In this particular case, you informed, it's a personal communication, and that personal communication is making a violation of clause 6. Plus, over and above, you are not communicating to your existing client. You are communicating to those who are not your client with the intention to grab those clients. And that's why it would lead to advertisement. And while mentioning this particular fact, you are also saying that you have also having some partner who was a partner of one of the leading firm in the world that indicate the professional achievement, and that's why it would be treated as violation of clause 7 as well. So in a current case, as we made the communication with the intention to do advertisement, and as we disclose the professional achievement, it would be treated as violation of clause 6, clause 7 of part 1 of first schedule Chartered Accountant Act 1949. Next question. Mr. Enterprising, who recently started his practice, has put up signboard outside his office describing himself as a chartered accountant and management consultant. You keep in mind, recently I said that a CA in practice under clause 7 can mention yourself as a chartered accountant, or he can use the degree given by an university approved or approved institution. No other designation can be used. If he is an MBA, he can designate himself as MBA, but he cannot designate himself as management consultant. If he is designating himself as a management consultant, such kind of degree is not given by an university or approved institution, and that's why it would be clearly treated as violation of clause 7, part 1, first schedule. If we see the next question, be a chartered accountant in practice, is a partner in 3 firms, while printing his personal letterhead, B gave the names of all the firm in which he is a partner. A good question. Here in this particular question, I want to give you example. Suppose I am being a partner in 3 firms, Sion Sai Associate, Sion Pavagadi Associate, Sion Bhavsar Associate. You keep in mind, while printing the letterhead of Sion Sai Associate, I cannot mention the name of Sion Pavagadi and Sion Bhavsar. In the letterhead of one particular firm, I cannot mention the name of another firm. But when I draft my personal letterhead, I can mention the name wherever I stand as a proprietor or wherever I stand as a partner. Even if I am a trustee somewhere, I can also mention in my personal letterhead, because this personal letterhead of Urvish Shah won't be used anywhere else except for personal purpose. Suppose I want to take admission of my son in any particular school and I want to write a request letter. At that time, I will not make use of my professional letterhead. Rather, I will make use of my personal letterhead. And when I'm drafting my personal letterhead, definitely I can mention wherever I'm standing as a proprietor, partner, director or trustee, nothing is wrong. It won't be treated as violation of Clause 7, Part 1, First Schedule. You keep in mind when you are drafting letterhead of one firm, you cannot mention the name of the another firm. It would lead to violation of Clause 7. But when you are drafting your personal letterhead, you can mention the name of all firms and it won't be treated as violation of Clause 7, Part 1, First Schedule. But here in PM, the answer differ. Where they are saying, in this case, it would be treated as a violation of Clause 7 and we need to follow while writing the answer in the examination what is given in PM. And accordingly, it would be treated as violation of Clause 7, Part 1, First Schedule. At the same time, if you read the next question, T, a practicing chartered accountant, uses the designation municipal councillor apart from the expression FCA on his visiting card comment. You remember, recently we learned MP, MLA. You can become MP, you can become MLA, you can become municipal councillor. Nothing wrong. But at the same time, while you are making your visiting card, you cannot mention MP, MLA or municipal councillor along with chartered accountant in practice, because this kind of designation neither given by any university nor given by any approved institution. And that's why what is advisable, you keep two different cards, where in one card you mention yourself as MP, MLA and in the second card you mention yourself as a CA in practice. So in a current case, as he is mentioning municipal councillor along with the chartered accountant in practice, it would be clearly treated as violation of Clause 7, Part 1, First Schedule, Chartered Accountant Act 1949. If we see the next question, Mr. PB, a chartered accountant, obtains registration as a Category 4 merchant banker under the SEBI rules and regulation and act as advisor to the capital issue of MB Company Limited. He designate himself under the caption merchant banker in the client offer document and advisor to the issue in his own letterhead, visiting card and professional documents. There are two parts of this question. Can we become a Category 4 merchant banker? Nothing wrong. We can become, being a CA firm. Afterwards, we can work as a merchant banker. And we are knowing as and when there is a public issue, they need to prescribe the name of merchant banker. So, in case of public issue process, if our name is mentioned as a merchant banker, nothing is wrong. But at the same time, on your professional document, visiting card, letterhead, you can't mention you are advisor to the issue. Advisor to the issue, such kind of designation neither given by any university nor given by any approved institution, and that's why it cannot be used. Again, I repeat, your name can be there in the prospectus of a company as a merchant banker, your firm name, nothing wrong. But on your own professional documents, you cannot mention advisor to the issue. Else it would be treated as violation of Clause 7, Part 1, First Schedule of Chartered Accountant Act 1949. Dear students, till now we learned 7 clauses. If I give you a reminder of all 7 clauses of Part 1, First Schedule. First of all, you remember we are learning Chartered Accountant Act 1949 amended in 2006. Within Chartered Accountant Act, there are 2 schedules, First Schedule, Second Schedule. First schedule, where council is taking decision. Second schedule, council is referring this matter to the High Court if needed. In a first schedule, we are having 4 parts, part 1, 2, 3, 4. Part 1 applicable to CA in practice, part 2 CA in service, part 3 CA in general, part 4 other misconduct. In second schedule, we are having 3 parts, part 1 CA in practice, part 2 CA in general, part 3 other misconduct. We started with the first schedule, part 1, in which we learned 7 clauses. Clause number 1 was saying a CA in practice cannot allow anyone else to use his firm name except a partner or employee, provided employee is also CA in practice, and there wasn't even a single practical related with that particular clause. Second clause was related with a CA in practice should not share his fees with anyone else except a partner, retired partner, legal representative after death of partner, any other professionals permitted within regulation 53A and any other CA in practice. Third clause, we cannot share the fees of others, but yes, we can share the fees of those who are sharing our fees under clause 2. Clause 4 was saying within India we can make partnership with two, a CA in practice and other professionals permitted within regulation 53B, and in abroad we can make partnership with three, whoever is permitted within section 415, whoever is being permitted by central government or council. Clause 5 was talking about we cannot secure work through wrong means and wrong person. Wrong means are the means which are not open to the chartered accountant, and wrong persons are who are not allowed it to be our partner. Clause 7 was talking about advertisement, personal communication, appearing for interview and circular, strictly prohibited for us. And clause 7 was talking about we cannot disclose professional achievement and we cannot use the designation other than chartered accountant. Apart from that, I want to give you certain tips for learning this subject of audit. As I said earlier, we need to manage this subject in three parts. First of all, your preparation should be better preparation. You need to devote 15-20 days for this particular subject. More or less, I have seen students are avoiding this subject till end, and towards end they are not getting enough time to study and they are just having overview of the subject. In fact, there are three parts: read, learn and learn by heart. Certain things in the subject of audit you will have to learn by heart. Example, clauses of professional ethics. Example, essay number. Example, section list. Otherwise, certain things you need to learn. You should have specific words. Simple reading won't suffice. So when you are making your preparation for 20 days, you need to learn and you need to learn by heart. Simple reading is not enough. Plus, while reading for those 20 days, you should make summary. That summary should cover the entire subject, which you can revise on the last 2 days. After accountancy paper, there would be one leave, and then after there would be a paper of audit. Meanwhile, if you are not in a position to revise the entire subject, if you don't have a summarized material, your confidence level would be very down. So even though you might have prepared very well earlier, on the last day, if you are not revising the subject, it would be useless. You would be able to see only 30-40% syllabus, and that will not raise any confidence for you. You will be morally down, and you would be facing that last day first time in your life. But being experienced, we have seen this last day many times. On an average, on a last day, students are giving us call that instead of asking any technical question, they are asking us what chapter we should skip. We don't have enough time. So better you need to have summaries to revise on a last day. Then only your confidence would boost. And third thing which you need to manage, that is 3 hours of examination. You need to complete your paper. You need to present it in a very well way. You need to decide sequence well in advance. What question you will attend first, what question you will attend second. And last 15 minutes, you need to audit your paper of audit. What does it mean? You need to read your answer, because what is happening? As and when you are writing any sentence, you always think of next sentence, and that is forcing you to commit mistake in ongoing sentence. Like you thought you want to write section 141, but you were in hurry and you have written 114. You thought you have written 141. But in fact, you have written 114, which is not there in your knowledge. Now it would go into the hands of paper checker. You thought that you should get 55 marks, but you committed such 10 mistakes. And that's why instead of 55 marks, you are getting 45 marks or 40 marks. Many a times you wonder, I have written perfect, still I am not getting marks. The major reason behind that, while writing, you always think of next sentence, which is forcing you to commit mistake. And what is a solution? Last 15-20 minutes we need to devote for reading our paper, specifically numerics. Wherever we have mentioned the number, essay number, clause number, sections, we need to check it and we need to make sure that they are correct. Accordingly, if you are doing, you will get the same marks what you expected. Otherwise, you will not get the same marks what you expected. For reading the paper for last 15 minutes, you need to complete your paper in a 2 hour and 45 minutes in a scheduled time. So it requires a time management also. So three types of managements are needed. One, 20 days preparation for the subject of audit. Second, last day summary preparation. And third, 3 hours management while writing in the examination. Moreover, I want to convey, for preparation there are 5 tools. Number 1, read. Number 2, learn. Number 3, revise. Number 4, present. And number 5, appear. Reading is not enough. You need to learn. Learning is also not enough. You need to revise again and again. Revising is also not enough. You need to write minimum 5 papers of audit before approaching the ultimate examination. And ultimately, you should appear for ICIS examination. Many students simply read and they go. Many students read and learn and they appear and they fail. Many students read, learn, revise, but they don't present. You need to write minimum 5 papers of audit before you approach for ICIS examination. Accordingly, you will secure your marks. I am representing Navkar Institute, which is the pioneer institute for CA coaching in the territory of western part of India. Number of chartered accountants we have produced and we have generated ranks at all the level. Moreover, on an average, there are 5,000 students studying it under a single roof with a great infrastructure, and we get the students from Gujarat, Maharashtra, Rajasthan, MP. And basically, to cross these borders, we decided to go with a virtual platform. Here, we won't provide you only one subject. We will provide you the complete solution, a virtual form of Navkar Institute. We will conduct your examination. We will evaluate your papers. We will give you necessary suggestions related with your studies. There would be mentorship. It won't be like you will just view the video lectures. But apart from that, we also know we are being the pioneer because Navkar Institute was established in the year 1997. And that's why we are aware what should be done for the purpose of cracking the examination, all 8 papers in a first attempt. So here I am welcoming you again in Navkar Digital Institute. Thank you.
If you like this video, share it with your friends. Subscribe to our YouTube channel to watch more such videos and learn from our expert faculty members. Press the bell icon to get regular notifications whenever we upload a new video. Download NDI mobile app to get complete CA course online. We value your support. Thank you for watching.